Hello, everybody. Dr. Carlo Oger, emergency physician. This video is about the Glidoscope, using the Glidoscope to help intubate a patient. This patient, these are his the vital signs: 108 heart rate, pulse oximetry 94%, blood pressure 159 over 72. The patient took a medication overdose and was very sedated, would intermittently have low oxygen levels, and because she was obtunded, lethargic, she was having trouble protecting her airway. So the decision to do an elective intubation was made, so we have plenty of time to get ready and get the Glidoscope downstairs. We should keep him in the ICU. This Glidoscope is a special instrument that has the intubated laryngoscope, but with attached camera. This allows us to visualize, not only for the physician, but everybody else to visualize as we're entering the patient's throat area and see the cords, and supposed to help the intubation, making it much easier. Also, the intubating laryngoscope has a curved blade. You can see it was plastic and it's curved, so it falls usually in between the tongue and the epiglottis, and it's a lot less traumatic, a lot less manipulation of the patient's neck. So when the patient's large in size, short chin, short neck, intubation is going to be difficult. You definitely want to use an instrument like this or similar kind of device to do this kind of intubation. So we had time to prepare and use this instrument, and this is my first time using this specific Glidoscope. The previous one I used was very, very much similar to the regular blade. It just had a camera attached to it. This one's a little different. It was more curved and shorter, so you're going to see that I had a little difficulty just getting the tube in. So the patient's being pre-oxygenated right now with a bag and valve to make sure the patient has the most oxygen reserves. That gives us the most time for us to do the intubation. And so the patient's sats were 94, 95, but as we are bag valve ventilating, we bring it up to 100. And the more you keep it at 100 before you start doing the procedure, the more time you'll have to do what you need to do. Make sure you always have suction available and it's ready to go, that you have all the emergency airway in case you need any complication or anything. As I'm introducing the blade into the patient's throat, you can see there's a lot of secretions there. So all those secretions were just laying there, and the patient could potentially aspirate them. Right now I'm trying to reach over for my suction catheter, but it wasn't turned on, so I had to have them turn on, and that cost me a few seconds, maybe even half a minute to get that there. And the secretions were very posterior, so even though I'm socking around the tongue area, I wasn't getting in. You can see starting getting to view right in the middle of the screen. That's the patient's airway right there. At one point I'm going to go back so you can see the epiglottis fall back on it, but right there in the middle of the screen, that's the epiglottis coming into view right there on the top of the screen. And right in the middle area there, those are the vocal cords, and you can see when the patient breathes in and out. And you can see in the bottom right of the screen right there, that was the endotracheal tube coming into view. And the trouble I had was getting that endotracheal tube to move up through that. These Glidoscopes have a special one-handed guide wire that allows the tube to curve up easier. But it wasn't pushed all the way in. It was done by the respiratory techs, not by me. So it wasn't pushed all the way in, so it wasn't curving into that area. All I was doing, you can see I'm moving a lot of the tissue, but I can't get that tube right up into that space. So eventually, you know, even though I'm looking, I'm seeing the airway, that's the spot I want to hit. The tube's not curving enough for me to do that. You can see now that's the epiglottis going to view again, and I just removed the tube to give us time to reventilate the patient. Patient saturation did drop to 70-something%, but as soon as we ventilated, 30 seconds later, we're up in the 90s again. Second time around, I use a regular blade. I guess I'm old-fashioned. I've used it for a long time. It allows me to see things better, and once I'm there, it lets me push the tube right in. Glidoscopes are supposed to help you, especially more difficult airways, but it does have a learning curve. Like everything else in medicine, you have to learn how to use it and how to do the things you need to do. So at this point, I'm showing that the patient is intubated, an endotracheal tube 8.0. We're inflating the balloon. This is to prevent movement and to create a tight air seal so that we can completely control the airway and the amount of air going in and out. You see we're pushing air through that bag into the tube. We also have right there, I was showing an end tidal CO2 detector. That's a little colorimetric test that changes yellow if there's CO2 on the tube. That's one way to confirm that the tube is in the right place. Also, we auscultate the chest, make sure that there's good aeration, and of course, saturations of oxygen back to 95-96%. So the patient's intubated properly. Of course, we'll do an X-ray to make sure.